Hello and welcome to News 11. I'm Danielle Harris.
And I'm Hyland Sanders. Coming up, news on weapon investigations in Iraq.
And we'll have the latest on a change in the stock market. News 11 starts now. Forces are holding a man believed to be the leader of an Iranian special forces group that's been involved in the Iraq war. American military investigators also say they found a new evidence indicating Iranian involvement in the Iraqi conflict. Barbara Starr has more.
The U.S. military has recovered another stockpile of weapons it believes were made in Iran and shipped into Iraq to kill U.S. and Iraqi soldiers as well as civilians. Troops showed off hundreds of components discovered in a Shia village north of Baghdad. It had all been buried in several large containers and covered up with palm leaves. The seizure included mortars and rockets and more than 150 metal discs to be used in making explosively formed penetrators, armor-piercing bombs the U.S. says are coming in from Iran. The troops say capturing this stockpile will make a difference.
They're expensive, they're complex to manufacture, and you've got to put them together. So taking this away from the enemy has definitely set him back, and we're certainly on the offense in the area.
Officially, the Pentagon says it cannot prove the Iranian government has authorized weapon shipments into Iraq. And some analysts question whether these components are really Iranian. Some are not of the high quality typical of Iran.
Well, I think that smoke and gun evidence is going to have to be something that has Iranian markings on it, something that unambiguously indicates that it's of Iranian manufacture. There's a lot of circumstantial stuff that we've seen thus far, but I don't think anything of smoke and gun quality.
Without the smoking gun evidence, some analysts say this latest seizure demonstrates that Iraq is developing the capability to manufacture and assemble these advanced weapons without Iran's help. Barbara Starr, CNN, the Pentagon.
The United States has decided to put its name on a list of countries meeting with Iran and Syria this spring. The meetings, which will start next month in Baghdad, will discuss what can be done to stabilize Iraq. Iraqi Foreign Minister Hashyar Zebari says the decision by President Bush to join the meetings is very significant.
At the U.S. military base in Bagram, Afghanistan, a suicide bomber blew himself up in an apparent attack against Vice President Dick Cheney, who was inside the camp at the time. The blast happened outside the gates of the camp, killing an American soldier and 19 other Allied soldiers. Vice President Cheney was unharmed and was moved to a different location after the blast. The suicide bomber is said to be a member of a Taliban terrorist group.
Yesterday in Iraq, 23-year-old Army medic Chris Rowland of Albuquerque pled guilty to the unpremeditated murder of a soldier in Iraq. After a night of heavy drinking, Rowland shot and killed Private Dylan Paytas of Freedom, Pennsylvania. Rowland pled guilty to murder and violating a general order against drinking. He faces life in jail without parole.
Paintings by Pablo Picasso have been stolen from his granddaughter's home in Paris. Diana Winmar, Picasso's home was broken into yesterday. The stolen artworks are estimated to be worth $66 million. Other recent robberies include the theft of an abstract watercolor painting in Mexico. Authorities believe the robbers will try to sell the paintings on the black market.
In a surprising turn of events, the stock market plummeted yesterday. Ali Velshi has more.
It was the drop heard around the world.
We were looking at the worst sell-off since March 24th of 2003 when the Dow dropped 300 points. Right now we're off the charts.
U.S. markets took a dive Tuesday, wiping out $600 billion in value and eliminating all of this year's market gains and more. At a point in the day, it was the biggest one-day point loss since markets reopened after the September 11th attacks. But why? Trouble started before dawn overseas. Word of an attack on a U.S. base in Afghanistan. Vice President Dick Cheney was nearby. Then news of the biggest drop on Chinese markets in 10 years. And before markets opened, more bad news. A report showed that U.S. businesses are buying fewer big-ticket items, like vehicles and computers. The drop was the biggest on record. Within 6 minutes of the opening bell, the Dow was down 100 points. Then news of another drop in existing home prices.
I think there was a market overreaction.
By 1 p.m., losses had accelerated. The Dow was down 200 points. Surprising, but not alarming. It hovered in that range for about 2 hours. At 2:59, losses had reached 300 points. Then, within a minute, it was down 400. A minute later, 546 points. Suddenly, a largely ignored comment made Monday by former Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan loomed large. He'd said a recession was possible. The Dow finally closed down 416 points, or 3.3%. The broader S&P 500 down 50 points, or 3.5%. The NASDAQ down 96 points, almost 4%. A round of boos on the floor of the New York Stock Exchange. Traders saying there was more to this sell-off than meets the eye. And then an acknowledgement from Dow Jones that their tabulation systems failed. A separate statement from the New York Stock Exchange talked about an intermittent technical problem. Basically, the volume of trades sent systems into overload, making what would have been a gradual drop in numbers a sudden one. In the end, was this a market rout, a technical glitch, an overdue correction, or the perfect storm? Who knows? But what's the average investor to do?
The key is really not to panic based on one day's activity and do something that you might regret later, like selling a stock that actually is a very good, solid, healthy company.
Ali Velshi, CNN, New York.
The markets rallied this morning with the Dow Jones Industrials up 52.31 points and the S&P 500 up 6.36 points.
After the break, more about a delayed launch of Shuttle Atlantis.
And we'll tell you about Governor Perdue's visit to Washington, D.C.
Stay with us.
Education is the key that opens a door to endless opportunities, adventures, and experiences. Without education, life is a continuing cycle of closed doors. This message brought to you by the United States Air Force, because we know the value of a good education.
Guys, what do you got?
Got a 28-year-old black male, got three gunshot wounds to the chest. One upper chest, one lower chest, one center. Bleeding a lot.
There are two paths a child can take.
Sir, try not to move.
We have a 28-year-old male.
For over 25 years, we've been helping children choose the right one. Communities and schools, helping kids stay in school and prepare for life.
He gave the best years of his life in defense of our country. He lost his leg during Desert Storm. He struggles every day to cope with this disability. Don't you think he's done enough? Why don't you do your part? Don't take a hero's space.
The launch of the Shuttle Atlantis will be delayed again thanks to a violent hailstorm Monday night at Cape Canaveral. Winds gusted up to more than 60 miles per hour, blowing golf ball-sized hail at the 15-story tank. The next shuttle launch was scheduled for April 7th, but that has now been pushed back to late April.
The Earth Day Network, an international environmental organization, has released its 2007 Urban Environment Report. The report ranks 72 U.S. cities according to over 200 environmental health and quality of life indicators. Atlanta ranks 64th with its lowest scores coming in parks and recreation opportunities, along with water and air quality. The president of the Earth Day Network says the report is unique because it redefines the term environment to include quality of life issues like public health, poverty, and education. The only other southeastern cities that ranked lower than Atlanta were New Orleans and Jackson, Mississippi.
Last week, Governor Perdue attended the National Governors Association's winter meeting in Washington, D.C. Following the meeting, Perdue and 13 other governors sent a letter to Congress urging it to take immediate action to fund the Children's Health Insurance Program known as SCHIP. A 2007 federal funding shortfall puts SCHIP in jeopardy. In March, Georgia will be forced to suspend all new enrollment in its Peach Care program. Perdue says Peach Care is a successful program that ensures Georgia's children have health care coverage.
Georgia is ranked 18th in the nation this year in a new economy index. A study by the Information Technology and Innovation Foundation ranks states in categories ranging from foreign investments to state exports and even things like the amount of internet domain names. Robert Atkinson, the author of the study, says states must create an environment that fosters innovation and high skills in order to help fast-growing entrepreneurial firms expand. Georgia was ranked number one in the broadband telecommunications category and placed sixth in the nation for the fastest growing firms.
State Senator Don Balfour is sponsoring a bill in Georgia that will require girls entering the sixth grade to have vaccinations for human papillomavirus, or HPV, which causes cervical cancer. Senate Bill 155 contains the exemptions for parents who oppose the bill for religious reasons or who can't afford it. A new estimate by the Centers for Disease Control found that one in four U.S. women ages 14 to 59 is infected with the HPV virus.
For some teenage girls, shopping is the norm. But for two Cobb County teens, it's a different story. The two girls robbed a Bank of America branch inside a Kroger grocery store Tuesday in Cobb County. Police were surprised that on the surveillance tapes, the girls were laughing while robbing the store. The girls handed a note to teller demanding money.
Valdosta Regional Airport has good news for passengers. Airport officials have compared prices and say that fares for Valdosta's airport have steadily declined since September 2006. At one point, those fares averaged $180 more per ticket than at Jacksonville Airport. The average difference is now only $3. Atlantic Southeast Airlines is the only airline providing flights from Valdosta Airport. Officials hope to one day have multiple airlines offering services from Valdosta.
Expansion of the Lowndes County Jail continues at a good pace. News 11's Cameron Nesbitt looks at the new construction.
During Monday's work session, the Lowndes County Board of Commissioners discussed plans for proceeding to the next phase of construction of the Lowndes County Jail. After the first phase of the building completed 2 months ahead of the schedule, the expansion included the state-of-the-art intake, a kitchen, laundry, and medical and administration facilities. Now the contract is finally negotiated and they will discuss the second phase during regular session.
The space that we needed that was getting too small for us over in the old section. Well, it's a much needed expansion. We got some kinks in here that we got to work out, and some growing pains we're suffering right now, but everything will be fine once we get all that figured out.
The jail was originally built to house 200 inmates, but now it's averaged more than 700. With the second phase in progress, it will include an administrative building, a courtroom, more housing, and a new visitation facility.
So far, the expansion of the Lowndes County Jail has been completed. For future years, the jail will remain a great success. For VSU News 11, I'm Cameron Nesbitt.
Looking at weather, today we'll have mostly sunny skies with a high of 83 degrees and a low of 57. Tomorrow expect rain and a high of 76 with a low of 64. Looking ahead to Friday, we'll have early morning showers with a high of 69 and a low of 52 degrees. Switching to pollen, medium high readings today and Thursday will lower to medium on Friday.
Neil Folger joins us in just a moment with news on Valdosta State Lady Blazers.
Stay with us.
Plastic ones last longer.
Pork bellies close steady due to speculation that demand for bacon-related products.
Read me this one, Daddy.
Okay, honey.
The less art kids get, the more it shows.
Are yours getting enough? Art. Ask for more. AmericansForTheArts.org.
Drivers face all kinds of distractions. Before your wireless phone becomes one of them, stop. Drive safely. Keep your phone in easy reach and dial sensibly. In bad weather or traffic, call later and use a hands-free device. Remember, with wireless, safety is your call.
This is firstgov.gov.
Brand new student loan applications on the site, baby.
This calls for a celebration.
Where we're obsessed with getting you government information.
What are those?
Government surplus cars for auction.
You posted those online last time.
No, you did.
I'm posting them online this time.
Just log on or email us and get what you need. Firstgov.gov.
I'm Neil Folger, and here is your look at sports. With a 50-46 win over the West Florida Lady Argonauts on Saturday night, the Valdosta State Lady Blazers wrapped up one of the most successful seasons in recent years. Their final record of 22 wins to 5 defeats, with 11 conference victories to 1 GSC loss, puts VSU atop the Eastern Division for the second time in 3 years. A youthful team with no seniors on its roster, the Lady Blazers now focus their attention on bringing home conference gold in the GSC tournament in South Haven, Mississippi. In 2005, they fell 2 seconds short of capturing the title with a loss to Central Arkansas. But now, with a mix of playoff-experienced veterans and eager underclassmen, VSU wants a taste of something that eluded them 2 years ago. With one of the nation's stingiest defenses, the offense has been picking up steam as of late, and head coach Kylie Hill knows that has always been practice.
Well, I think the two biggest things are, I'll just keep it at one right now, is consistency on both sides of basketball. Defensively, we've done that entire year. Right now, we're still second in the country. Defensively, only giving up 45 points a game. Offensively, just have our ability to stay confident shooting the basketball. And understanding where we're trying to attack, how people are defending us, and consistently making those reads. That's been our overall game plan.
The Lady Blazers start their run to the GSC title tomorrow as they will play the winner of the West Florida Harding game at 6:30. If victorious, VSU will take to the court in a semifinal matchup Saturday at 1:30. The GSC tourney title game, televised on MediaCom Channel 99, is Sunday afternoon at 1. That's not all for the Lady Blazers. The GSC office released the all-conference basketball honors for the 2006-2007 season yesterday, and many faces are familiar to Blazers fans. Junior guard Carly Peterson was selected to the all-GSC East first team, junior forward Kaylee Thomas is an all-GSC East second teamer, and coach Kylie Hill was voted as the GSC East Coach of the Year. With 1 year under his belt as VSU head coach, Mike Helfer went out and recruited his own players, something his 2005-2006 squad lacked. What a difference that made. The 20-7 Blazers, armed with an 8-4 conference mark, take to the court Friday afternoon at 3:45 in South Haven, Mississippi, against the Bison from Harding University, the third seed from the GSC Western Division. Valdosta State, the second seed from the East, knows the path to the conference title game will be difficult, but assistant coach Jeffrey Porcher says the team's goal is still cutting down the nets on Sunday and points out players instrumental in getting the team to that spot.
Or to come in first place. We came in second place in the East, but we're going to the tournament. We're going to look to win the tournament. Valdosta State men's basketball team has never won the, you know, Gulf South tournament, so we're looking to do a first there. That's one of our goals, so that's still in sight. And then make it on to the regionals, what we want to do. And then once you get to the regionals, anything can happen. Mike Crane is one of the, you know, best players that's probably ever came through here. Then Herman Burge has dramatically stepped up his game offensively, defensively. You know, he set the season all-time assist record this year for Valdosta State. And DeVario Hudson, the transfer that we got from Duquesne, has been playing really, really well of late. You know, we just got to keep playing well. And our role guys are doing a great job, too. You know, you got Lusane and Coons in there. And, you know, Derek Allen's been stepping up big the last couple of games. So we just got to keep that going in the conference tournament.
Firing and defeat Harding, their semifinal game will be Saturday night at 6:30. As mentioned, the men's title game, also televised on Channel 99, is Sunday afternoon at 3:45. As with the ladies, the Gulf South Conference announced the men's all-GSC East basketball honors yesterday, and Valdosta State was definitely represented. Senior guard Herman Burge burst onto the conference scene this year and is rewarded by being selected to the all-GSC East Division first team. Fellow senior Mike Crane and junior transfer DeVario Hudson found their names on the all-GSC East second team. Will Thompson pitched 8 scoreless innings, struck out 7 Hurricane batters, and got his second win of the year as VSU defeated Georgia Southwestern yesterday in America's 3-0. Daniel Muniz, Dustin Rucker, and Brandon Atkins had an RBI apiece in the non-conference win for the 11-8 Blazers. Billy Grant Field will be busy the next few days as conference opponent Wachita Baptist comes into town for a 3-game series this weekend with games Friday afternoon at 4, Saturday at 1, and Sunday at 1:30. The golf team shot 11 over par yesterday to claim a 5th-place showing at the AASU Southbridge Pirate Invitational hosted by Armstrong Atlantic State Monday and yesterday. Junior Jason Flowers won the tournament, posting a 4 under 140. He joins Josh Tompkins as the only golfers to win a tournament this year. Sophomore Bobby Dyer tied for 10th overall with a 146. Tompkins got 36th with a 154, while Kevin Dutkowski and Nate Balanis tied for 39th at 155. Valdosta State will next play in a tournament it hosts, the Southeastern Collegiate at Kinderlew Forest Golf Club on March 19th. The Lady Blazers softball program, teaming up with the athletics department, wants to build a brick walk of fame at the softball complex. With a donation, former softball players will have their name, number, and position engraved on a brick and placed on the walk. The proposed site for the softball walk of fame is outside of the new locker room facility. For more information, you can contact Coach Thomas Massera at 229-333-7405. The current softball team will not take the field again until Sunday at 5 when it hosts Lander for a doubleheader. Bobby Tucker, Valdosta State's faculty athletic representative and director of compliance, has been awarded the Georgia Athletics Trainers Association Warren Morris Sports Medicine Person of the Year. Tucker has served as assistant basketball coach, professor, athletic trainer, faculty athletic representative, and director of compliance and academic services in his 29 years with the university. Tucker is also an American Red Cross volunteer and is key to the numerous blood drives organized by VSU's athletic department each year. The Warren Morris Sports Medicine Person of the Year Award is given to those individuals, companies, or institutions promoting athletic training within Georgia. In local sports, the Lowndes High Viscats steamrolled Tri-Cities 50-29 last week in the opening round of the Georgia High School Association State Basketball Playoffs. Their second round game takes them away from Lowndes County and into Middle Georgia on a neutral court. They will clash with Douglas tomorrow afternoon at 4 p.m. at Fort Valley State University in Fort Valley, Georgia. And finally, Matt Kenseth won the Auto Club 500 at the California Motor Speedway this past Sunday. Drivers and companies now have 2 weeks before the next NASCAR race, March 11th in Las Vegas. And that's your look at sports.
Thanks, Neil. Following the break, international food and fun in Valdosta.
Stay with us.
I could reach the sky. Pour one down for you. So you could see the truth that I can change the world. I would be the sunlight in your universe. And if I could, I'd change the world.
I want my money back. This parrot doesn't talk.
Yes, he does.
Play-Doh, how can this man get a passport?
1-800-BIT-INFO.
The bird's a brain.
How can this man find out about Social Security benefits?
1-800-BIT-INFO.
Play-Doh here knows the number for the Federal Consumer Information Center, where you'll find all you need to know about government benefits and services.
Really?
Well, a 1-800-BIT-INFO, yeah.
I'll keep him. He talked me into it.
He talked me into it.
I was a liberal arts major in college.
I didn't speak a second language.
What could I?
What could I offer the Peace Corps? The answer surprised me. I served in South Africa teaching HIV/AIDS awareness.
Working with my students in Nicaragua was a great experience. We taught each other a lot about our countries and cultures.
This is the Peace Corps today.
Redefine your world. Join the Peace Corps.
Apply now at peacecorps.gov.
The Valdosta Lowndes County Conference Center and Tourism Authority Board is launching a new marketing campaign aimed at attracting more business to the conference center. Some groups say they're avoiding holding events or meetings at the center because of cost concerns. The new marketing campaign will run in April and will offer rental rooms at a discounted rate based on attendance and the purchase of catering services.
The Valdosta State University Office of Alcohol and Drug Education is holding a safe spring break fair in Palms Quad. The annual event will be held next Tuesday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Activities will include a DUI cone course and a rollover simulator. Participants will also be eligible for prizes and will enjoy music and free food.
Do you like cuisine and entertainment from around the world? If so, don't miss the 31st Annual International Dinner and Dance Show at the James Rainwater Conference Center this Friday. There will be dishes from over 30 countries, as well as various dance troupes. Tickets for the events can be purchased from the Center for International Programs. Call 333-7410.
The VSU Opera presents a dinner theater this Friday and Saturday at 7 p.m. Performances will be in the Magnolia Room at the University Center. Dinner and a show is $30 and reservations are required. They can be made by calling 333-2150.
No plans for Friday night? Well, downtown Valdosta has the solution. First Friday has free events including artists, live music, refreshments, and more. It all begins at 6 p.m. and runs until 9:30. For details, contact the Main Street office at 229-259-3577.
The first lunar eclipse in over 2 years will occur this Saturday. If the weather cooperates, the VSU Observatory in Nevins Hall will be open from 6 to 9 p.m. Parking is limited. In addition to viewing the eclipse, visitors may also view the planets Venus and Saturn, the Pleiades star cluster in Taurus, and the Great Nebula of Orion. For more information, call 333-5752. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Danielle Harris.
And I'm Hyland Sanders. See you next week.
Hello and welcome to News 11. I'm Laurie Dickey.
And I'm Chantel Copeland. Coming up, news on a plane crash in Indonesia.
And we'll have the latest on the search for natural resources off the Florida coast. News 11 starts now. A plane crash in Indonesia causes pandemonium this morning. CNN's Dan Rivers has more.
Within seconds of overshooting the runway, Garuda Airlines Flight 200 was an inferno. This remarkable video was taken by a news cameraman who was aboard moments after he'd scrambled out. In spite of his injuries, he manages to film the awful scene behind him. Inside the burning fuselage, passengers who weren't so quick. Many horribly burnt, stretchered away by rescuers who fought the flames for 2 hours. But incredibly, many did make it out alive.
We were about to land, and the plane was going lower and lower, but unlike the usual process of landing, we got turbulences. Even when we're just a little above the roof of houses, and suddenly we got like a bump And then we hit the ground for a while. And when it stopped, I already see a fire outside of the plane. I sat on the right side of the plane, so it's the fire was outside the window.
Among the 140 passengers and crew were 9 Australians preparing for a visit by the Foreign Minister Alexander Downer. They included embassy officials, police officers and journalists.
Well, we have no reason to believe this accident was as a result of sabotage or a terrorist attack or anything like that. It does look like just a straight accident where the aircraft apparently ran off the end of the runway.
Hospitals in Yogyakarta were inundated with more than 90 injured passengers and crew, with distressed relatives desperately praying for good news.
What caused this plane to catastrophically overshoot the runway and burst into flames is still not clear. It's possible it was simply coming in too fast along the runway, skidding off the end and smashing through this fence. But it's also possible there was a problem with the landing gear. Either way, the Indonesian president has now ordered an urgent investigation as to why this flight ended in such horrible tragedy.
On New Year's Day, an identical Boeing 737-400 operated by Adam Air mysteriously plunged into the sea off Sulawesi, killing all 102 people aboard. Now, there are renewed concerns about Indonesia's air safety record. The key question, was this mechanical failure or a pilot error? Downriver, CNN, Yogyakarta, Indonesia.
A search for new oil supplies off the coast of Florida is causing some unease in the American oil industry. Morgan Neal explains why.
Tattered as it may be, the Chinese flag already flies over some small oil rigs on Cuban soil. Now many in the U.S. government fear China could soon move into the Florida Straits in search of bigger oil reserves.
Right next door, stand on a high place in the lower Florida Keys, and someday you may see an oil rig, and it won't be ours. It could be Red China's.
A U.S. Geological Survey study in 2005 indicated the North Cuba Basin could hold substantial deep water reserves of crude and natural gas. Nothing like the huge deposits of the Middle East, but much closer to U.S. shores. China has already been drilling onshore in Cuba for years. Offshore, Canada, Spain, Norway, and India have all bought rights to plots off Cuba's northwestern coast. Professor Jonathan Benjamin Alvarado is an expert on Cuban energy policy.
There's a potential for investment in the billions of dollars on the part of the United States, especially in the energy infrastructure.
That can't happen as long as the U.S. trade embargo on Cuba remains. Embargo supporters say it keeps money from the coffers of Fidel Castro's government. But as one proponent of trade with the island points out, U.S. competitors face no such obstacle.
They're going to get their oil. It's a question of whether they get it in partnership with India, Canada, and Spain, or in partnership with the United States. So our relevance to their economic future is getting less and less each month and each year as other companies from around the world step in.
If there's one industry with the influence to seriously threaten the embargo, it would seem to be big oil.
But for now, the embargo stands in the way of a sector starved for new opportunities, and the clock is ticking. Currently, Cuba is still selling plots here off the coast, but once drilling begins, other sections could disappear quickly.
And that could happen soon.
I would say that within the next 2 to 3 years, we could legitimately see oil drilling.
Analysts say a partnership with U.S. companies would make a lot of business sense in terms of technology and proximity. But the decision on whether U.S. companies will take part or leave the field open to rivals like China won't come from Havana, but from Washington. Morgan Neal, CNN, Havana.
Unhappy with President Bush's handling of the Iraq War, more than 30 Vermont towns passed resolutions yesterday calling for his impeachment. Citizens of 32 Vermont towns are sending a message for Congress to file articles against Bush, saying he misled the nation on Iraq's weapons of mass destruction and also engaged in illegal wiretapping.
More members of the Ohio baseball team involved in the deadly bus accident in Atlanta are going home, but coach James Grandy remains in serious condition in an Atlanta hospital. The Bluffton University team was on their way to Florida for a game last Saturday when their bus plunged into Interstate 75 from an overpass. Many players walked away mostly unharmed before died, as did the bus driver and his wife.
A $52 million housing project off Bemis Road, adjacent to Moody Air Force Base, is facing numerous problems. News 11's Taylor C. has more.
Work on the Magnolia Grove Housing Project has come to an abrupt halt. Dozens of local contractors have failed to receive payments for their work on the project from American Eagle Communities. The company out of Meriden, Connecticut, received a contract to build more than 150 homes on property near Moody Air Force Base. Captain Gary E. Arison, Jr., the public affairs chief at Moody, told me that although the housing project will serve the base, the project is owned, managed, and developed by American Eagle Communities. This means that Moody has no involvement with the financial affairs of American Eagle Communities, and that financial obligations to its subcontractors is a contractual and financial arrangement that must be resolved by the companies involved. Dozens of local contractors and businesses have yet to be paid for their services, including the Home Builders Association of South Georgia, CMS Dumpster Corporation, and Southeastern Stud, just to name a few. I spoke with Maurice Bayman, the owner of Preferred Builders and Renovators, about his involvement with the project.
SRC is performing the contract for American Eagle, and the same guy owns both companies, and they've given me several letters with promises and intents to pay, and those deadlines, of course, have passed. This has been over several months' time. I've been very patient.
With this issue having a major impact on many small businesses here in Valdosta, let's hope for an immediate resolution to the problem. For News 11, I'm Taylor C.
Students flocked to VSU's Palms Quad yesterday for a safe spring break fair, and News 11 Lindsay Ferguson was there too.
Spring break is just around the corner for VSU students. Many students will be going to party destinations such as Panama City, Cancun, Daytona Beach, and others. The VSU Alcohol and Other Drug Education sponsored the Safe Spring Break Fair yesterday at the Palms Quad on campus. Students learned about the dangers of drinking and driving. There was a DUI cone course and a rollover simulator. Police officers from Jessup were on hand to educate students.
Educate folks on the importance of properly wearing seat belts. We also have a demonstration set up with some videos that shows the effects of alcohol and driving automobiles or driving under the influence while impaired.
Many other organizations were there, such as the VSU Police Department, Georgia State Patrol, South Georgia Medical Center, The Haven, and the Farber Health Center at VSU. One of the nurses at VSU had this to say about Safe Spring Break.
We're giving out sunscreen and information on melanoma and skin cancer, and we're giving away visors and keychains.
The fair encouraged VSU students to have a safe spring break, and I hope you'll do the same. With News 11, I'm Lindsay Ferguson.
After the break, YouTube helps fight crime.
And we'll tell you about President Bush's visit to America's Georgia.
Stay with us.
You have coverage if that tree in your front yard ends up in your living room. Seat belts protect you in the event of an accident. You go through life being protected in dozens of ways. And if you're an investor, your personal safety net includes the Securities Investor Protection Corporation. It is there to return your securities in the unlikely event that your brokerage firm fails. That almost never happens. But don't you feel better knowing that the SIPC is there for you if you need it?
It's springtime in the forest of the black-tailed deer. The young male is feeling playful. It's time for tag. The female flicks her ears, her way of saying, catch me if you can.
Be part of a growing movement, Tree City USA.
We care for our town's trees.
And we plan for their future.
Support Tree City USA where you live. Go to arborday.org to learn which trees to plant where. You can find out how to contact your state forester for community forestry assistance.
Help the Arbor Day Foundation plant more trees.
arborday.org.
The internet socialization site YouTube, originally designed for users to upload home videos, is now being used by police to catch criminals. The Franklin, Massachusetts Police Department posted a surveillance tape from a credit card robbery at Home Depot store on YouTube in hopes that viewers might recognize the two men involved. A handful of other police departments have also started using YouTube, believing it could be a new way to help solve crimes.
Two Georgia teachers are behind bars for having sex with a 17-year-old female student. DeKalb County police arrested 29-year-old UB Lewis of Stone Mountain and 28-year-old Clarence Hicks of Lithonia on Sunday and charged them both with sexual assault. Hicks was also charged with providing alcohol to a minor. Both men are now banned from their classrooms at Miller Grove High School.
President Bush spent last Saturday in America's Georgia looking at tornado damage and listening to people talk about the effects of the twister that hit last Thursday. Sumter County lost many historic homes, retail businesses, and most of their medical facilities. President Bush has promised assistance to both Georgia and Alabama. In Georgia, 9 people were killed, 10 died in Alabama, and another person was killed by a tornado in Missouri.
Jenna Bush, the 25-year-old daughter of President Bush, is releasing her first book. Anna's story, A Journey of Hope, will be published by HarperCollins. It's a story about a 17-year-old single mother in Panama who struggles with HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. Jenna Bush is currently working in Panama as an intern with UNICEF.
John Cooley, the convicted sex offender who has been charged in the death of 9-year-old Jessica Lonsford in Florida, has told detectives that he would apologize to Lonsford when he met her in heaven. Cooley is on trial for the kidnapping and murder of Lonsford after sneaking into her home and abducting her. Deliberations will begin after closing arguments from lawyers.
In local news, Dr. Mack Greer was honored last week for his work at Farber Health Center. News 11, Adobe Nwaneli has more.
Family and friends gathered at the Farber Health Center on February 22nd to honor Dr. Mack Greer. Dr. Mack Greer worked for Valdosta State University for over 20 years. He was a physician and director for the Farber Health Center and also an associate professor of biology. He retired in 1994 and passed in 2002. Dr. Greer was remembered by both those who had the pleasure of working with him and those who knew of him.
Dr. Greer was the best of the best, and it was a pleasure and a blessing every day that I worked with him.
His wife, Betty Greer, and children remembered him by donating a portrait of Dr. Greer that will hang in the Farber Health Center.
I think this was a wonderful occasion, and I'm so pleased with everything that was done in his memory. And it was just extra special, and I'll always remember this day.
As you can see, Dr. Mack Greer's legacy will continue to live on. For News 11, I'm Adobe Manelli.
Valdosta is joining the worldwide effort to stop violence against women. News 11's Lee Matthews tells us how.
Eve Ensler's V-Day brought men and women of all ages to VSU's UC Theater this weekend. V-Day began as a motion to stop violence against women and girls and is sweeping across the globe.
V-Day is very, very important for bringing information about women's rights and women's liberation, as well as bringing involvement to the community to raise money against women's violence.
V-Day launched Until Violence Stops in 2006 and plans to continue the Vagina Monologue in an effort to educate the world and end violence against women.
It brought a lot of things to light for me as far as domestic violence, which we should all know about on some level, but some people overlook it and they don't dig deeper.
A friend, actually a couple friends that have been, domestic violence has been a hard part of their life, and I've had to watch them go through it. And I heard about this, and it's just a voice for women, you know, and it's a creative way to be like, hey, listen, speak up, this happens, we need to stop it.
The V in V-Day stands for Victory, Valentine, and Vagina. V-Day is a fierce, wild, unstoppable movement and community. News 11, I'm Lee Matthews.
Looking at weather, today we may get some showers with a high of 70 degrees and a low of 50. Tomorrow, expect sunny skies and a high of 76 with a low of 45. Looking ahead to Friday, we'll have mostly sunny skies with a high of 70 and a low of 46 degrees. Switching to pollen, medium-high readings throughout the week with a high reading on Saturday. In just a moment, Rachel Bedsole has news with sports.
And you have news on the Blazers basketball teams.
That's right. Both teams advanced to the national tournament. I'll have that and more next in sports. Stay with us.
428 Essex, Pollock on the premises.
220, we're on it. Just roll.
In there.
Yeah, we'll handle this, man.
What?
We're ready to be very civil about this.
You never know when a polyp is going to show up. Get the polyp early and stop colon cancer before it even starts. Just get a test from your doctor. Get the test, get the polyp.
Nice surgeon's touch.
Get the cure.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
In these turbulent times, let us not erode the liberties our country was built on.
Let it shine.
I am the port in the storm.
Coast Guard Reserve.
I'm Rachel Bedsole, and here's the latest in sports. With a 69-42 victory over Harding last Thursday, the Lady Blazers basketball team fell short against Arkansas Tech Saturday in the semifinals of the GSC tournament. VSU held the Golden Suns without a basket for the final 4 minutes of the game, but it was not enough as the Blazers lost 62-51. The Lady Blazers jumped out to an early 12-6 lead in the first 5 minutes of the game before Tech began to take charge. The Golden Suns had half their total point scores come from the charity stripe as they hit 31 of 38 free throws in the game to seal the victory. Nina Risto and Kaylee Thomas scored 10 points each to lead VSU, and the team shot 33.3% in the game. While the Lady Blazers rolled over Harding, the men didn't have such luck. The Blazer basketball team fell short last Friday when they took the court against Harding in the quarterfinals of the GSC tournament. The Blazers lost 73-72 when Harding's Reggie Bibb banked a three-pointer as time expired to secure the comeback win for the Bison. The Blazers ended the first half with a 28-27 lead and opened the second half with a 15-3 run to take a 53-38 lead. The Bisons, led by all GSC player Matt Hall, went on an unbelievable 35-19 run to end the game. Herman Burge scored 17 points to lead the Blazers, while DeVario Hudson and Jamal Stokes finished with 12 each. VSU shot 41.5% in the game and had 8 steals. For the third time in the last 6 seasons, the Blazer basketball team has advanced to the NCAA postseason. The Blazers are one of 42 teams to earn an at-large bid and will enter the tournament as the number 7 seed in the South Regional. Coach Mike Helfer's squad will face off against Rollins, the region's number 2 seed, in the first round of the national tournament on Saturday at Host School Montevallo. Game time is 3:30. The men are not the only team to advance into the tournament. The Lady Blazers also received an at-large bid to the NCAA tournament. Being placed as the number 4 seed in the South Region, the Lady Blazers will face number 5 Tampa in the first round Friday evening at 5 at Host School Florida Gulf Coast. After sweeping Lander University in a doubleheader Sunday night, the Lady Blazers softball team, now ranked 9th in the nation, took the field Monday only to win another doubleheader. The Lady Blazers defeated the Florida Tech Panthers 5-1 and 4-1, making that 9 straight wins for VSU. Kristen Lindsay pitched her 6th win, giving up 9 hits and striking out 6 in 7 innings. Robin Williams went 2-for-2 with a walk, while Alex Acosta went 1-for-3 with a run scored and 2 RBIs. Brianna Colas took the mound in game 2, giving up 3 hits and striking out 4 in 7 innings. Shannon Cleveland was 3-for-3 with 2 runs scored, while Robin Williams was 2-for-3. The Lady Blazers will travel to Hawaii and take on Hawaii Pacific Sunday. After suffering a tough 12-inning loss to a Wachita Baptist Sunday afternoon, the Blazer baseball team kept their spirits high to defeat Flagler yesterday. VSU took advantage of a Flagler error in the bottom of the seventh, scoring three runs to aid in the defeat over the Saints 4-2 in non-conference play. On the mound, Will Thompson allowed six hits and walked five while striking out four in nine innings. Thompson was also named GSC Pitcher of the Week yesterday. Nick Copeland and Justin Huff had two hits each to lead the Blazers while Brandon Atkins scored two runs. VSU takes the field again today against Georgia College at Billy Grant Field. Game time is 4 p.m. Blazers are away this weekend at perennial powerhouse Florida Southern and don't return home again until March 21st. On Monday, VSU head football coach David Dean announced the 2007 football schedule. The Blazers will play in three televised games this season. The first televised game of the year will be at Arkansas Tech, and the other two will be at home against Delta State and West Georgia. Of a team that went 8-2 overall and 6-2 in the GSC last season, VSU returns 47 letter winners, including 22 starters. Gearing up for the 2007 season, the Blazer football team finished its first week of spring practice Monday morning. The Blazers took the field for their first session under Dean last Wednesday. Saturday featured the team's first scrimmage of the spring. The Blazers will hold two more practices this week before breaking for spring break. The annual spring game is set for Saturday, March 31st at Bazemore Hyder Stadium. After rebounding from a 2-1 deficit in doubles, VSU claimed victories in 5 of 6 singles matches to defeat Auburn Montgomery in non-conference men's tennis. 3 of the 5 singles victories went into 3 straight sets. The Blazers take the court again Friday to play Alabama Huntsville in Pensacola. And that's your look at sports.
Thanks, Rachel. Following the break, big winners in the Mega Million jackpot drawing.
Stay with us.
The time is coming. There's no escape from the day you retire. And will you be ready financially?
Are you ready, dear?
You still can be with investments like an IRA or a retirement plan at work. It's never too late. But start now, because if you wait...
You're making a grave mistake.
You may wind up working forever. Saving for your financial future doesn't have to be a nightmare. Choose to save.
Properly inflating my tires burns less fuel and saves me money on gas. Yeah, I'm saving Mother Nature from pollution, but more importantly, she saved me $11.
Ow! Environmental events, get green.
By keeping my car regularly tuned, I save money on gas and repairs. That also means cleaner air. You know, feels good to help save the cash planet.
Environmental events, get green. For more tips, go to getgreen.com.
Valdosta State University, Georgia's regional partner, combining classroom and research opportunities, giving students the skills they need to achieve in a new millennium. From water purification research to archaeological excavations, Valdosta State students and professors work together in the laboratory and in the community. Hands-on learning, real-world research. Valdosta State University is Georgia's regional partner.
The lives of two people have changed dramatically after beating the odds of 1 in 176 million and winning the Mega Million jackpot, which reached a record high of $370 million. The two winning tickets were sold in Georgia and New Jersey. The estimated cash option value of the tickets will be split between the two winners and is estimated at a little over $221 million before taxes.
Valdosta and the surrounding areas are preparing for the 2007 Special Olympics. Competitions this year will be in volleyball and track and field. The events will be held on March 21st and 22nd. For more information, contact Tammy Crosby at 333-1817.
The VSU Scythe team has captured first place in the Duel in the Desert competition in Tuscan, Arizona, this past Saturday. The team consisted of Daniel Housley, Nadia Rajob, Stephanie Spencer, and Jason Swinford, who competed against 4 other universities. The competition is one of the kind in the nation. Along with the first place prize, VSU took home a trophy and $4,000.
At 1:44 a.m. last Friday, a call for help came to the Valdosta Fire Department from the Georgia Mutual Aid Group. As storms tore across the south, a team from the VFD made their way to Baker County to assist in rescue efforts in the city of Newton. The VFD worked alongside fire department personnel from Decatur, Albany, Camilla, and Thomas County. The VFD is one of the four search and rescue teams in Georgia.
The City Engineering Department is making traffic improvements around Valdosta. Beginning next Tuesday, there will be a new lane assignments and signal signs at the intersection of Bay Tree Road and Norman Drive. The northbound right turn lane on Norman will no longer be in free flow lane. There will now be two eastbound lanes approaching Norman Drive on Bay Tree Road, and the inside westbound lane on Bay Tree will now be a straight left lane. Work on Jerry Jones Drive and Hillendale Road will begin on Monday. It will involve the widening of Jerry Jones to make an eastbound turn lane. There will be a detour up Berkeley Drive during construction. Finally, to control traffic on Georgia Avenue westbound, traffic will now be required to turn right at the Oak Street intersection.
One of Valdosta's most anticipated events will take place this weekend. The Azalea Festival will be kicked off on Saturday with a 5K road race and a 1 mile run walk. Festivities will continue throughout Saturday and Sunday in Drexel Park. You'll be able to enjoy food, arts and crafts, music, and many other fun activities. Events will take place from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. on both days. For more information, visit azaleafestival.com.
Get ready to mark your calendar. Daylight saving times begins at 2 a.m. on Sunday and will end at 2 a.m. on November 4th. Be aware of this change because it is not on the first Sunday in April as it has been for the past 20 years. Congress extended daylight savings time by 4 weeks in order to save energy. Also, instead of falling back in October, we will fall back on the first Sunday in November. Some cell phone and computers will change automatically, but others will have to be manually updated.
Dale the Movie, a documentary on the life of racing legend Dale Earnhardt, makes its debut in South Georgia this week. The movie, narrated by Paul Newman, opened in Daytona last month and will continue to follow the NASCAR circuit throughout the additional race markets. The movie will run through Thursday night and will also play next week, March 13th through the 15th at Valdosta Stadium Cinema 16. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Laurie Dickey.
And I'm Chantel Copeland. We'll see you next week.
Hello and welcome to News 11. I'm Cameron Nesbitt.
And I'm Lindsay Ferguson. Coming up, news on refugee camps in Iraq.
And we'll have surprising developments in Medicare. News 11 starts now. Iraq insurgents are forcing families to become refugees. CNN's Kira Phillips reports from a refugee camp in Iraq.
When you enter the Al-Batul refugee camp, you see the filth, smell the sewage, and imagine the dangers. It's depressing. And then you meet the children.
I think what amazes me the most about all these children is that they're still happy and positive. They have bicycles, they play soccer, and that's all they need right now. I ask them if they understand why they're here. They say eventually they hope to have a better life. They understand democracy. They understand freedom. This is all they know at this point, and they're just making the best of it.
This unexpected spirit surrounds us. We followed it. And then we met Shakria. Her name means thankful in Arabic. Ironic for a woman who has had everything taken from her. Look at this miserable situation, she tells me. Look at this room. What can I say? We're still saying thanks God. Shakria welcomes us into her home, even with so little. She and her husband, Mohammed, smile, laugh, and never once hint for any sympathy. Dignity dominates this humble home. Today, they're not forgotten. I'm very proud, she tells me. I'm very happy you're here. Seeing you compensates for the bad days. This visit gets me through the day. Their story is just like the estimated 200 Iraqi families that have taken refuge here. Insurgents threatened to kill them if they didn't leave their home. Shukriya explains, we can't find good clothes for our children. We can't offer them good food or send them to school. I sold everything, even my gas canisters and my furniture, just to survive. Now Mohammed supports his family as a street cleaner, earning $4 a day. They have five children to feed.
They have five children. What do they hold?
I asked Mohammed if his children ever question their circumstances. He tells me, my daughter Hannah asks me, when we grow up, what is going to happen to our destiny, to our future? Why do we have to live under these circumstances? Hey. The truth is, this family doesn't know. So they pray, they work, and they wait.
What is your message to the Iraqi government now?
Mohammed tells me, our message is to get rid of the terrorists, get our home back, and have security. Nothing more, nothing less. Kira Phillips, CNN, at the Al Batul refugee camp in Baghdad.
It's been 4 years since 75 Cuban dissidents were in prison. As CNN's Morgan Neal reports, their loved ones are now fighting back.
These women have been marching peacefully every Sunday since their relatives were arrested in 2003. Tuesday's march began like most of the others. The Damas de Blanco, or ladies in white, were calling for the release of their husbands, sons, and loved ones, dissidents jailed in a government crackdown 4 years ago. They marched to the prison authority and released doves as a symbol of their nonviolence. But soon a group of mostly female government supporters marched up alongside and the shouting match was on. I asked both sides what they were marching for. We're marching because it's been 4 years since the government locked up 75 innocent men for expressing themselves, Berta of the Damas de Blanco tells me. Those women over there were prepared by the government, she says. I crossed to the other side and talked to the government supporters. Tell me what you're shouting, I ask. We're yelling, long live our Cuban revolution. No, what you just yelled, I say. Mercenaries is what we said, because they sell themselves for money to foreign governments. I'm a black woman, and my family is poor, and everything I have is thanks to the revolution, says her neighbor. But soon the Damas de Blanco find refuge at a member's house. Once inside, they celebrate. Outside, a crowd of onlookers that's gathered quickly scatter when I ask their opinions. The only comment I can get from this young man, who says, I agree with everything, but you can't talk here. And just like that, our rare glance at a public show of opposition to the Cuban government is over. Morgan Neal, CNN, Havana.
A new report says 5 million more people are suffering from Alzheimer's disease now than 5 years ago. The 10% increase is expected to rise once the baby boomers generation reaches their mid-60s around 2011. The report is based on federal population counts and not scientific studies, and it comes on the heels of a congressional decision to consider funding more on Alzheimer's research.
Georgia Representative Barry Fleming, who is the majority whip, introduced a controversial death penalty bill into the House yesterday. Current law states that for someone to be sentenced to the death penalty, all 12 jurors must unanimously agree. Representative Fleming amended the bill on the House floor yesterday. Its provisions would require only 10 out of 12 jurors to agree on the death penalty, and the judge's ruling would be the final decision.
A 12-year-old Boy Scout who was lost for 4 days in the mountains of North Carolina has been found. Michael Arbery was found about a mile from the campsite where he was last seen Saturday. Arbery was found in good condition, except for a little dehydration, scratches, and bruises.
The Medicare program might be affecting how much you pay in taxes. CNN's Joe Johns has some disturbing information about the use of Medicare money.
21,000 doctors, healthcare professionals, suppliers who get paid by the Medicare program, that's your tax dollars, didn't pay their income taxes or payroll taxes in 2005. And if that's a tough pill to swallow, how about this? An audit by the Government Accountability Office found some of them are using your tax money for the good life. Luxury automobiles, fancy homes. One doctor even bought this pleasure boat. If it sounds like taxpayers are getting taken for a ride, listen to what one senator says.
They should be angry that the federal government is putting money in the pockets of folks who are thumbing their nose at the rest of us and simply not paying their tax obligations.
And we're not talking about chump change. Those 21,000 healthcare professionals owed the government more than $1 billion. That's right, a billion. But to be clear, it's not only about the money. It's also about the quality of service some of these tax cheats have been providing Medicare patients.
The GAO also said some doctors received Medicare payments even though they'd gotten into serious trouble, like being reprimanded or having their licenses suspended or their hospital privileges revoked.
Substandard care, drug abuse, lack of moral character, embezzlement, abusive prescription writing, that doesn't sound to me sound like people we should have doing business with the federal government.
But they have been, and they're getting away with it because the government has no policy to prevent people who owe tax debts from getting Medicare money. Even the administration says it's unbelievable.
I am outraged that there are Medicare providers out there right now harming our beneficiaries.
I get a sense that this issue has, for whatever, the outrage doesn't filter down.
In fact, keeping them honest, the Health and Human Services Department already has a way to collect some of those back taxes. It's called a levy program, and some on Capitol Hill are wondering, why doesn't Medicare just go after the money?
You came to a hearing on how to collect unpaid taxes, and you don't even know how many levies you've collected. I think, that's pretty much in the category the dog ate my homework.
But even with the Senate howling, let's be clear, this has been going on for at least 10 years, and no one's fixed it yet. More than anything else, it's the bureaucracy that makes it hard to catch Medicare tax cheats and force them to pay. Joe Johns, CNN, Washington.
After the break, news about a recent shooting in Atlanta.
And we'll tell you about new immunization requirements for children.
Stay with us.
428 Essex, polyp on the premises.
Good 20, we're on it. Just roll.
In there.
Yeah, we'll handle this, man.
What?
We're ready to be very civil about this.
Mm-mm.
You never know when a polyp is going to show up. Get the polyp early and stop colon cancer before it even starts. Just get a test from your doctor. Get the test, get the polyp.
Nice surgeon's touch.
Get the cure.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
In these turbulent times, let us not erode the liberties our country was built on.
Let it shine.
I am the port in the storm.
Coast Guard or Coast Guard Reserve.
There was a shooting yesterday near Atlanta's Atlantic Station. This is the scene where two men got into an altercation resulting in gunfire. One man pulled out a gun and shot the other man, who eventually ended up lying in some shrubbery. The gunman sped off in a brownish golden sedan. The victim was identified by the Fulton County Medical Examiner's Office as 28-year-old Rodney Cunningham of Pensacola, Florida. Police are questioning a female witness.
The Bluffton baseball team has found a way to remember its players who died in a fatal bus accident. The tragedy occurred March 2nd in Atlanta after the team bus drove through an overpass and plummeted back onto a highway. In remembrance of the deceased, the Bluffton players will wear all black uniforms this season. Their first game will be March 30th.
Starting July 1st, all children attending childcare, pre-K, Head Start, and school facilities will need to have more immunizations. The changes were approved by the Georgia Department of Human Resources Board to try to reduce the number of preventable childhood diseases. Changes to vaccine requirements include a second dose of chickenpox and mumps vaccine or laboratory proof of immunity for children entering kindergarten, sixth grade, or Georgia school for the first time. Children will need a hepatitis A vaccine or laboratory proof of immunity for children enrolled in school who were born on or after January 1, 2006. Finally, children under 5 who are enrolled in childcare, pre-K, or Head Start must be vaccinated for pneumonia.
As a way to advance Georgia's drug-free workplace program, the Senate considering Senate Bill 96. This will allow employers to do oral drug testing on site. The test will use saliva as an alternative for urine. If results are positive, they will be confirmed in the laboratory. The Bill 96 changes will be in addition to pre-employment drug testing.
The City of Valdosta Engineering Department will be installing global positioning systems, or GPS, equipment on 10 traffic signals. With funding of $66,000 from the Georgia Department of Transportation, the equipment will let emergency vehicle drivers turn traffic signals green as they approach the intersections. The GPS equipment will be installed at the following intersections: Ashley A. Gordon, Webster Street, Valley Street, Central Avenue, and Hill Avenue, as well as Hill Avenue at Patterson, Tomb Street, Oak Street, and the intersections of Oak Street at both Central Avenue and River Street. 10 fire department vehicles will also have equipment to let drivers coordinate traffic signals for emergency purposes. Training with the new equipment is already underway.
This week, Georgia is celebrating its fourth annual National Agricultural Awareness Week. The week recognizes the importance of agriculture and agricultural business in the state of Georgia. Agriculture makes a large economic contribution to the state, with the sales of a variety of produce, including watermelons, peaches, Vidalia onions, poultry, and pecans. Governor Sonny Perdue helped kick off the celebration in Atlanta yesterday at the Georgia Freight Depot. About 60 agricultural organizations were represented and provided samples of produce.
This Friday, Wild Adventures presents Deaf Awareness Day. Hearing impairment will affect almost 48% of the population at some time in their lives. 9 to 22 people out of 1,000 will suffer from severe or total hearing loss. Participants will have the opportunity to attend interpreted shows, as well as other events. Reservations are required and can be made through the Wild Adventures website.
The South Georgia Regional Development Council, or SGRDC, hired the Genesis Group on January 19th to develop the first bicycle and pedestrian master plan for Lowndes County. The first phase includes identifying community goals and objectives, collecting data, and having a public stakeholder meeting. That meeting was held March 15th. The second phase includes having another public stakeholder meeting and creating an implementation to your input or to ask questions. Contact the Transportation Planning Coordinator at 333-5277. You can also visit valdostacity.com to fill out a comment sheet.
Looking at weather, today we'll have mostly sunny skies with a high of 80 degrees and a low of 55. Tomorrow will be partly cloudy with a high of 80 and a low of 54. Looking ahead to Friday, it will be sunny with a high of 84 and a low of 53 degrees. Switching to pollen, medium high readings for today, with Thursday and Friday readings increasing to high.
Lee Matthews joins us in the moment with the highlights in sports, right?
That's right, Cameron. We'll have the latest on the men's golf team.
Stay with us.
They came from every corner of the country, from small towns and big cities. But they all shared one thing in common. They belonged to a family called Marines. A tough and determined few, dedicated to protecting everything we hold sacred. history of those proud few who have earned the title Marine.
Did you know you have the power to stop children from joining gangs? You can help a father find a job and home for his family. You can assist a woman who can't afford the medicine she needs to live and the home she can't live without. You can choose to make a difference. Support the programs that are working in our community. Contact Volunteers of America today.
I'm Gary Sinise. In the movie Forrest Gump, I played Lieutenant Dan Taylor, a disabled veteran. But being a disabled vet is much more difficult. It often means a life of hardship, loneliness, and pain. You can help by volunteering at your local veterans hospital. You will brighten a disabled veteran's spirit and remember those who've sacrificed for our freedom. So please get involved and contact the Disabled American Veterans.
I'm Lee Matthews. Here's the latest in sports. The Blazer golf team hosted the Southeastern Collegiate this weekend at Kinderloo Forest Golf Club in Valdosta. With 14 of the nation's top 25 golf teams, the tournament had one of the strongest fields all year. The Blazers finished in a tie for seventh place, with the win going to the University of West Florida. Jason Flowers led again the Blazers with a tie for 24th. Kevin Dukowski, Bob Dyer, Chris Mirzwa, and Josh Tompkins also helped the Blazers make a second-day charge in the tournament. The golf team will be in action next on March 26th and 27th at the Bobcat Invitational in Eatonton, Georgia. Taking three or four games last week in Hawaii, the Lady Blazers opened up a conference with a sweep over West Florida yesterday in Pensacola. They won the first game 5-3 with Kristen Lindsay pitching her eighth win of the season. Shannon Cleland and Christina Eli were the biggest offensive producers for the Lady Blazers, with three RBIs between them. The Lady Blazers shut out the Lady Argos 8-0 behind GSC Pitcher of the Week, Brianna Collis. Alex Acosta, Ashley Mayhew, Eli, and Chantrell Edwards each knocked in runners to help VSU with the win. Next up for the 19-3 and 8th-ranked Lady Blazers will be the doubleheaders at West Georgia and at West Alabama this weekend. Their next home game will be Monday against Georgia Southwestern at 5. Four university presidents and 8 U.S. presidents have served time in office during Tommy Thomason's career as VSU baseball coach. News 11's Neil Folger has more on this Blazer baseball pioneer.
Over the past four decades, springtime in Valdosta has signaled the start of the azaleas beginning to bloom and the Valdosta State baseball team starting its season under the same field general. Since 1967, Tommy Thomas has held the reins of the Blazer baseball program. It is hard to imagine VSU without number 3 in the dugout, but come 2008, a new face will lead this historic program. Thomas will retire following the 2007 season.
I was too young to even think that far ahead back then. No, I don't think there was any thought about how long I would be here, but I tell you what, I am very thankful that I'm still here, and I have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people to thank that I am still here.
After graduating from Valdosta State College with a business degree, Thomas got his first coaching stint at Georgia Southern, but was lured back to his alma mater by his college baseball coach, former VSC athletics director Billy Grant.
I was supposed to be his assistant for 4 or 5 years. That was the plan. That's what he told me. After about 2 weeks, he called me in and says, "I'm just not going to have time for this. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you."
Now at the helm, Thomas immediately instilled a new persona into the baseball program, and its rewards were soon to follow. Conference titles, playoff berths, and national recognition came VSC's way, but 1979 was a year that trumped those all. The school's first athletic national championship. 27 years removed, little has changed around the baseball fieldhouse. Thomas, surrounded by his awards and accolades, is still busy coaching. Assistant coach Shannon Jernigan, who played under Thomas in the mid-90s, said it's a bit different coaching with him than playing under him.
In terms of what he teaches, in terms of being the complete person, that hasn't changed a whole lot, but just seeing the things that he does day in and day out, just working with them on that type of basis, you see a lot of the things that kind of go behind the scenes as a player, and you really recognize that more as a coach.
Senior catcher and team co-captain Richard Flores says that the tradition of excellence and winning that Thomas established at VSU caught his attention.
He convinced me basically by his record. You know, I knew I was coming to a winning program by coming here to VSU, so that was pretty much the big thing right there.
So what does retirement hold for Division II's all-time winningest head coach?
I want to travel a lot, and I want to travel with my golf clubs. I love golf.
Closing in on 1,300 wins, Coach Tommy Thomas is a true living legend here at Valdosta State University. Reporting for News 11, I'm Neil Folger.
The Blazer baseball team returns to the field after a weekend off when they travel to Alabama Huntsville when they open up Gulf South Conference play this weekend. The Blazers will next be home April 3rd against Thomas University. Turning to the women's NCAA tournament, all number one seeds are in the Sweet 16. However, Maryland, the defending champions, are out. Number 7 Mississippi Rebels ousted the number 2 Terrapins last night, winning 89-78. Ole Miss shot 55% on the floor and forced 20 turnovers in the first half. This is the biggest upset in the tournament, as the Terrapins had won their last 7 games and had 31 consecutive non-conference wins. Games for the women's Sweet 16 will begin Saturday. The men's side also has all its number one seed going into the Sweet 16. The defending Gators look to win in St. Louis Friday night against Butler and have high hopes to go back into Atlanta in 2 weeks and win their second consecutive title. With only 3 weeks left in the regular season, NBA teams are fighting for playoff berths. Denver, who has had a 5-game win streak, is only 9 games behind the division-leading Utah Jazz. And the defending champions Miami Heat are only a half game behind the Washington Wizards. Only 8 teams can continue into late April, and March almost over, there is a fight for the finish. And that's your look at sports.
Thanks a lot, Lee.
Following the break, we'll have more on a candlelight visual in Valdosta.
Stay with us.
Somewhere around the world, there are men and women of the armed forces risking their lives, helping rebuild communities after natural disasters, collecting toys for needy children, tutoring kids in school. These are your sons and daughters who work to keep us safe, secure, and free. Dedicated men and women who put their country first.
Valdosta State University, the pathway to success.
I love VSU because from the moment I came here, it's just been like a second home.
This place was just like home for me, and I love it. I'll always love it.
Just above the Florida border, VSU is a second home for students from all over Georgia, 47 states, and 58 countries. A quality university degree, a unique second home, a great location. Valdosta State University, your pathway to success.
Following the tragic events of September 11th, there have been hundreds of violent attacks against innocent Americans.
Remember what that flag you're waving stands for.
Remember, please stop the hate.
We're stronger when we are united.
Remember.
Remember what that flag you're waving stands for.
One nation under God.
Indivisible.
With liberty.
And justice.
For all.
In America, there's either room for everyone or it's not America.
Don't pick the wrong fight.
Let's keep America land of the free.
Stop the hate.
Valdosta will honor Dr. Martin Luther King on Thursday, March 29th with a candlelight vigil. April 5th marks the 39th anniversary of Dr. King's assassination. The vigil starts at 8 p.m. at the corner of South Ashley Street and MLK Drive. A local pastor will be a keynote speaker at the event. For more information, call 244-0867.
VSU students, take note. Registration for summer and fall classes begin Monday at 9 a.m. All students must be advised before being allowed to register, so be sure to see your advisor immediately. Students should also take care of any holes that might keep them from signing up for classes. If you're unsure about your status, you can check it out by logging in by VSU's banner website.
A new scholarship will help seniors at Valdosta and Lowndes High Schools. The Rosa Parks scholarships will be awarded to students who have a commitment to excellence. The scholarship program will be kicked off this Saturday at 7 p.m. in the Valdosta High School Performing Arts Center. For more details, call 241-1288.
This past Sunday, many South Georgia and North Florida homeowners went to the Valdosta Comfort Center to get some home improvement ideas. News 11's Dan Fifield also stopped by.
Residents from Valdosta and surrounding areas gathered at the James H. Rainwater Conference Center for the Home Builder Association of South Georgia's 6th annual Home and Garden Show. Vendors were able to showcase a variety of items, trends, and services from jacuzzis to cookware to the latest trends in powering your home. Scott Orstein, president of the Home Builders Association, expects a large turnout for this year's event.
We're really excited this year because we've got over 100 vendors here, just about maximum capacity.
Orstein also said vendors are easy to recruit because of the visibility and subsequent business they receive from the event.
We put a lot of hard work into the show, and you know, we feel that it provides us with a lot of different aspects of our business to bring it back up to steam.
Despite all the new products, the biggest hit with the kids this year was Home Depot's booth, which gave instructions and tools for building birdhouses and picture frames. From kids to their parents, homeowners to renters, Orstein says this year's event has something for everyone.
It's just an exciting time. People want to get out this time of year as spring comes in to get in the yards and do home improvement projects, and we have that here. We have experts here that are able to advise you. I mean, what better opportunity, free advice this weekend from builders to, again, to remodelers, developers. They're all here this weekend. So.
This weekend's Home and Garden Show at the James H. Rainwater Conference Center provided residents of South Georgia and North Florida with new, innovative ways to renovate their homes for this spring and upcoming year. For News 11, I'm Dan Fifield.
The Shamrock Shuffle, which is a 5K run walk, will be held this Saturday. The race will start at 8 a.m., but check-in is at 7. All participants will receive a T-shirt. There will also be prizes for those finishing first, second, and third in each age group. There is a $10 entry fee if you register today, or $15 on Saturday. All proceeds will benefit the American Cancer Society Relay for Life.
Auditions ended yesterday for Valdosta Theater Guild's production of Bo Jess. Directed by Tammy Glasscock, the play is about a Jewish girl with a problem. Her parents want her to marry a Jewish boy, but she has other plans, and falls in love with a non-Jewish boy. The play will run at the Valdosta Playhouse in downtown Valdosta May 3rd through the 6th and May 10th through the 12th. For more information, visit TheaterGuildValdosta.com. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Cameron Nesbitt.
And I'm Lindsay Ferguson. We'll see you next week.
Hello and welcome to News 11. I'm Neil Folger.
And I'm Joy McCullough. Coming up, we'll tell you about a hostage situation in the Philippines.
And we'll tell you about a debate among political parties concerning troops in Iraq. News 11 starts now. A bizarre hostage situation in the Philippines is now over. Dozens of preschool children and their teachers have been released. CNN's Anjuli Rao has more.
The hostage drama finally came to an end after the 32 children and their four teachers were trapped on the bus for 10 hours in the blazing Manila heat by the main hostage taker, Jun Ducat. The children are now in hospital being looked over by doctors in case they've suffered any physical ailments while they were on board the bus. As for Jundikat himself, he and his accomplice have been questioned rigorously by police here in Manila. Tomorrow they are expected to be charged with kidnapping, abduction and child abuse. Still though, it appears that his demands were met. The government has said that they will give the children at the daycare center that he founded, the 145 of them, free education all the way until they finish college, which is pretty amazing considering the state of tertiary education in this country. So many children don't make it at all because of the cost of sending your child to further education. Perhaps amazingly though, Jundikat has an enormous amount of support here. When he was setting the children free, rather than being berated by the thousands of people gathered there, holding up placards saying we support Jundikat, don't punish him. People were lighting candles to support his drive for better education for this country's poor, and we know that there are so many of them still in this country. Many people still live on less than $2 a day. In fact, educational needs are in a very dire state at the moment. Many children going to school where they don't have teachers, they don't have resources, some of them even having to take lessons in toilet blocks and hallways, something that Jundikat says that he hopes will be a thing of the past, particularly in the run-up here in the Philippines to midterm elections later this year. Angelou Rao, Manila.
A female sailor seized by Iran last Saturday will be freed later today or tomorrow. Faye Turney was among 15 Navy sailors and Marines inspecting a merchant vessel at the northern end of the Persian Gulf when they were taken captive. Iran says the British military force entered Iranian waters, and the Iranian embassy in London says the captives are in good condition.
Zimbabwe's opposition leader, Morgan Tsvangirai, has been detained following a raid on the headquarters of the main opposition group. Zimbabwe President Robert Mugabe has threatened to remove Western diplomats from the country. Tsvangirai and other officials have also been beaten recently. The United States currently backs the opposition.
A bill that ties funding of the Iraq war with a set date for troop withdrawal likely will never pass. President Bush has threatened to veto it, as CNN's Kyung Law reports from Washington.
The clerk will call the roll.
The vote came down to the wire with a narrow victory for Senate Democrats. Republicans Gordon Smith and Chuck Hagel joined them in supporting a date for a troop pullout.
If we fail to build a bipartisan foundation for an exit strategy, America will pay a high price for this blunder, one that we will have difficulty recovering from in the years ahead.
The Senate bill ties $124 billion in supplemental spending for Afghanistan and Iraq with a troop pullout. The Republican minority says that sets up Iraq for failure.
Setting a date for withdrawal is like sending a memo to our enemies that tell them to rest, refit, and replan until the day we leave.
The bill now pits both houses of Congress against the White House. Moments after the vote, the White House issued a statement reiterating the president's promise to veto the bill. Democrats expect it, but say they hope the president won't pull the trigger.
Let's work with him and see if he can give us some ideas how we can satisfy the wishes of the majority of the Senate, the majority of the House, and move forward and complete this bill as quickly as we can.
This is a fight we're going to win. This is a fight we must win. And I think it's one of the most shameful pieces of legislation I've seen in 24 years as a member of the United States Congress.
The Senate will vote on the overall legislation sometime this week. The bill will then merge with the House version. Next, the president's desk, where he vows it will never become law. In Washington, I'm Kyung Law.
The American Cancer Society advises women thought to be at high risk for breast cancer to get breast MRIs. About 1.5 million American women are considered to be at high risk. They have some type of genetic mutations associated with Hodgkin's disease or have a family history of cancer. Women whose families have a history of ovarian cancer should be especially watchful.
Atlanta Police Chief Richard Pennington says certain police changes will be made as a result of the death of a 92-year-old woman in a drug raid. Katherine Johnson was killed after wounding three plainclothes police officers who entered their home with a no-knock warrant in November 2006. The drug raid resulted from a tip from a confidential informant. Pennington says 30 officers will now be rotated off narcotics duty every year. Top supervisors will now be required to sign off on narcotics operations and no-knock warrants. Supervisors must also witness confidential payments to informants. The Atlanta Police Department will also begin drug testing of all of its officers.
After the break, news about Sunday alcohol sales here in Georgia.
And if you're looking for a job, we'll tell you why some may become available shortly here in Valdosta.
Stay with us.
Head coach of Valdosta State Baseball. 8 trips to national tournaments. The winningest coach ever in Division II baseball. Valdosta State's first national championship. Sunday, April 29th, Blazer baseball coach Tommy Thomas makes his last trip to the mound at Billy Grant Field. Join us in thanking him for 40 years of great Blazer baseball.
Join the Valdosta State University Alumni Association's Tag Your It campaign by ordering your official State of Georgia VSU commemorative license plate. A minimum of 500 tag applications is required in order to produce the VSU plate. Just visit your local tag office or download an application form from the VSU website at www.valdosta.edu. A $25 manufacturing fee must accompany the application, and there will be a special tag fee of $25 next year when the new license plate arrives. Applications must reach the Georgia State Motor Vehicle Office by July 31st.
Northbound lanes on I-75 are closed for nearly 5 hours after a tractor-trailer overturned near exit 13. The driver, William David Shipworth of Ocala, Florida, died on the scene. Shipworth was not wearing a seatbelt and was partly ejected from his vehicle. The driver and passengers of a second vehicle involved in the mishap were taken to South Georgia Medical Center for minor treatments.
The Sunday alcohol sales bill appears to be dead. On Monday, the Senate Rules Committee refused to consider putting the bill on the 2007 agenda for debate. Many grocery and convenience stores pushed for the bill, asking for local communities to vote on allowing alcohol sales at stores on Sundays. However, Christian conservative groups lobbied against the bill, citing moral and religious concerns.
Governor Perdue announced his latest executive appointments last Friday. They included Lowndes County Sheriff Ashley Polk, named to the Board of Commissioners of the Sheriff's Retirement System of Georgia. Polk also serves as president of Valdosta Electric in Shiloh Farms and is chairman of the board of Guardian Bank and holds various other posts.
The South Georgia Regional Library will be undergoing changes at the end of this week. News 11's Danielle Harris has more.
By the end of this week, South Georgia Regional Library will be losing one of their most dedicated employees, but she's not leaving quite so easily. Liza Newsom is stepping down as director of South Georgia Regional Library. As a child, Miss Newsom loved libraries, and nearly 20 years ago, she realized her true calling.
I went back to library school and became the director of the Brooks County Public Library for 7 years, and now I've been director of this library for almost 12 years. And I have loved every minute of being a librarian. I was meant to be a librarian.
As director, Ms. Newsom has helped the library become stronger and more capable with the demands of today's technological society. But after retiring, she plans to help the library in other ways by volunteering.
I would like to encourage other people to volunteer. There's so much that needs to be done in the community, and we have so many talented folks in the community. Once you retire, it doesn't mean you have to stop giving. It means you can give more and more. So,
besides volunteering, Ms. Newsom also has a few other plans.
I'm going to read 1,000 books. I want to go to 1,000 places, and I want to keep in touch with all the wonderful people that I have met in the past 20 years.
This library contains a variety of users, 50% of which are college students. If you are interested in becoming a volunteer at South Georgia Regional Library like Ms. Newsom, please contact 333-0086. For News 11, I'm Danielle Harris.
The Lowndes County Planning Commission recommended approval of rezoning 291 acres from R10 residential to PD planned development Monday night. The rezoning would open the door for the development of 55 and older age-restricted retirement villages. The villages at Bodenwood bring 722 single-family homes and 130 condominiums to Lake Park near Twin Lakes. The massive development is just off U.S. 41, 10 miles south of Valdosta, and is expected to take 7 years to complete.
As many as 100 new jobs are coming to Valdosta. Stito Auto Sports is relocating their headquarters from Pompano Beach, Florida to Valdosta. Stita specializes in manufacturing Ford products. Expected to be operational in 18 months, the 25-acre facility will have manufacturing, engineering, and distribution facilities. Stita President Dario Orlando says its proximity to I-10 and I-75 makes Valdosta ideal for a distribution operation.
Last week, I had the opportunity to go out with rookie firefighters from the Valdosta Fire Department as they got to experience the thrill of tackling a real-life fire. Rarely are firefighters the culprits responsible for setting fires, but this house, located on 3rd Avenue in Valdosta, was the location for hands-on training for rookie firefighters with the Valdosta Fire Department. Fire Chief J.D. Rice explains the three-prong objective to the fire training.
First, we want to simulate rescue operations. We had a rescue dummy inside the structure that guys had to go and search each room by room looking for a victim by using a rescue dummy. Also, we prepped the house with roof ventilation. Typically, what we try to do, if we can't find the fire itself, if the environment is so smoky we can't find the fire, we'll chop a hole in the roof that would draw the heat and the smoke up through that ventilation hole and give us a clear area to work with. And then thirdly, we actually did firefighting operations.
By using a real house, the firefighters are able to prepare themselves both mentally and physically for the challenges they will embark on during a normal day's work.
The fear level's always going to be there, but we try to reduce that and make people feel comfortable and confident in their equipment and their ability to fight a fire in case they have that experience.
Chief Rice explains that though nothing can fully prepare firefighters for every situation that they will encounter, once they understand
the components of what you're doing and the equipment that you have on and how it's going to work for you, it really builds your confidence level tremendously. So when the guys came out and put their first fire out, they really felt like, hey, I can handle this job. I know what I'm doing now.
Well, so it looks like the drill went well. Did they learn anything out there?
They definitely did. And, you know, any opportunity that they have to tackle a real-life fire is a great opportunity. And, you know, it's not as hot as a fire outside, but it's pretty warm. You're looking at weather now?
That's right. Looking at weather, today will be partly cloudy, sunny skies with a high of 88 degrees and a low of 58. Tomorrow will be mostly sunny with a high of 86 and a low of 58. Looking ahead to Friday, it will be partly cloudy with a high of 79 degrees and a low of 55. Switching to pollen, pollen counts will remain high to the weekend with no relief in sight.
And in just a moment, Highland Sanders is going to be joining us with some sports. What you got for us today, Highland?
The Lady Blazers softball team continues its winning streak. That and more coming up.
Stay with us.
I could reach the stars. Pour one down for you. So you can see the truth that I can change the world. I would be the sunlight in your universe. And if I could, I'd change the world.
I want my money back. This parrot doesn't talk.
Yes, he does.
Play-Doh. How can this man get a passport?
1-800-BIT-INFO.
The bird's a brain.
How can this man find out about Social Security benefits?
1-800-FED-INFO.
Play-Doh here knows the number for the Federal Consumer Information Center, where you'll find all you need to know about government benefits and services.
Really?
Well, a 1-800-FED-INFO, yeah.
I'll keep him.
He talked me into it.
I was a liberal arts major in college.
I didn't speak a second language. What could I offer the Peace Corps?
The answer surprised me. I served in South Africa teaching HIV/AIDS awareness.
Working with my students in Nicaragua was a great experience. We taught each other a lot about our countries and cultures.
This is the Peace Corps today.
Redefine your world. Join the Peace Corps.
Apply now at peacecorps.gov.
I'm Hyland Sanders. Here's the latest in sports. The Lady Blazers softball team continues its winning ways by sweeping conference foe West Georgia Saturday afternoon. The 13th-ranked Lady Blazers defeated the Wolves 6-1 and 7-0 in the afternoon doubleheader. Kristen Lindsay picked up her 9th win of the year, giving up only 4 hits and 2 walks. The Lady Blazers proved to be too much for the Wolves in Game 2 of the series, with Brianna Collis picking up her 4th shutout of the season. The Lady Blazers' offense also got things rolling early, scoring 5 runs in the first inning with a 3-run home run from Alex Acosta. The Lady Blazers softball team was in action again Monday night, facing Georgia Southwestern at the softball complex. In the first game of the doubleheader, the Lady Blazers defeated the Hurricanes 14-4, scoring their most runs in a game all season. The Lady Blazers took over the game with a big 5th inning offensively, scoring 10 runs on just 5 hits. Alex Acosta ended all hopes of a Hurricane comeback with a grand slam in the 5th, followed by a 3-run home run by Talisha Ramsey. The Lady Blazers were even more dominant in Game 2 of the series, taking an 8-0 lead after the second inning. VSU went on to score 5 more runs in the 4th inning, putting away Georgia Southwestern for their 25th win of the season. The Lady Blazers will go for win number 26 and 27 when they travel south to face the Lions of St. Leo. After splitting a doubleheader against Alabama Huntsville Saturday afternoon, the Blazer baseball team defeated the Chargers 8-4 in Gulf South Conference play Sunday afternoon. Valdosta trailed 4-3 entering the final inning, but the Blazers knocked in 5 runs to claim victory. Thomas Tripp started for VSU and allowed only 9 hits, 4 runs, while striking out 6 in 6 innings before John Sermon finished out the game. Sermon allowed only 2 hits in the final 2 innings to pick up his 2nd win. VSU returns to action today against Columbus State at 5 p.m. in Columbus. The Blazers won't be home again until April 3rd. The Blazer golf team was again in action this past week for the Bobcat Invitational hosted by Georgia College and State. The Blazers struggled on day one, finishing in 14th place in the 15-team field. As always, the Blazers came back on day two, shooting the 3rd lowest score of the day with a 293. With a great final day score, the Blazers were able to move up 3 spots and finish in 11th place. The Blazers were led on the 2nd day by Bobby Dyer's round of even par 70. Jason Flowers, Kevin Dukowski, Josh Tompkins, and Chris Mirzwa also helped the Blazers in the 2nd day comeback. From the greens to the courts, the VSU men's tennis team defeated Lander University 5-4 Sunday afternoon at the tennis complex. The defeat over Lander put VSU 8-4 overall and 5-1 in Gulf South Conference play. The Blazers will travel to Pensacola this weekend to compete in the White Sands Invitational. The first match is Friday at 4 p.m. against St. Edwards. The Lady Blazers tennis team took the court last Saturday afternoon, only to defeat Florida Southern 7-2. With 3 doubles and 4 singles victories, the Lady Blazers extended their winning record to 8-0 overall and 5-0 in Gulf South Conference play. The Lady Blazers will travel to Pensacola this weekend to compete in the White Sands Invitational. And that's a look at your sports.
Thanks, Highland. Appreciate it.
Coming up, there's lots of laughs at VSU's latest theater production.
And we'll have a report on a zombie movie right here in Valdosta.
Stay with us.
428 Essex, polyp on the premises.
Good 20, we're on it. Just roll.
In there.
Yeah, we'll handle this, man.
What?
We're ready to be very civil about this.
You never know when a polyp is going to show up. Get the polyp early and stop colon cancer before it even starts. Just get a test from your doctor. Get the test, get the polyp.
Nice surgeon's touch.
Get the cure.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
these turbulent times, let us not erode the liberties our country was built on.
Let it shine.
I am the port in the storm.
Coast Guard Reserve.
The university system of Georgia is phasing out the test designed to screen out college university students with poor reading and writing skills. Chancellor Errol Davis told the Board of Regents yesterday that the system is implementing curriculum standards that would eliminate the need for the test. The Regents test has been administered annually since 1972 to college sophomores who must pass it in order to graduate.
Poet and author Lucy Tapahanso was scheduled to speak tonight in the UC Bailey Science Center. The event was part of the President's Lecture Series, but has been canceled. There's no word yet on whether Ms. Tapahanso's lecture will be rescheduled.
The VSU Theater Department promises nothing but laughs as they explore the improvisational art of Commedia dell'arte. The Commedia project combines elements of slapstick comedy in traditional scenarios, but with an original storyline. Look for elements of mistaken identities, over-the-top characters, and intrigue to form the foundation for the play. The Commedia Project is performed in Sawyer Theater and will run through March 28th.
The faculty and students of the Athletic Training Education Program are selling chicken dinner tickets for charity. The proceeds will go to the American Cancer Society's Relay for Life. The dinners can be picked up tomorrow at the Regents Bank on North Patterson.
VSU's Equal Opportunities Program presents the Little Talent Show next Tuesday at 7 p.m. in the UC Magnolia Room. Auditions are tonight at 7 in the same room. To participate, you must register at the Equal Opportunity Program's office. The event is free and participants are eligible to win prizes.
The Valdosta Fire Department Pipe and Drum Corps recently received an award in honor of the Daughters of Ireland. The Corps participated in the 183rd St. Patrick's Day Parade in Savannah. The Daughters of Ireland is an organization supportive of charitable and educational purposes, which also promotes the preservation of Irish heritage, culture, and humor.
It's the Day of the Dead for VSU students as they participate in a student movie. News 11 Cameron Nesbitt takes us there.
There's a lot of fun and a lot of fright as VSU presented Zombie Day. It is the very first and yet only event when VSU students participate in a student film production. The event was sponsored by the Campus Activity Board, Blaze FM, VSU's Centennial Hall, Alpha Psi, and Chamber 525, a student independent film group. The name of the production is entitled Waking Up to Hell. Executive producer Jason Geigerman shares his thoughts about Zombie Day and this movie.
It is a zombie movie, and it's being filmed here on campus. It's a lot like many other zombie films. The main thing about this one is that it follows three different timelines. There's three different stories of these different characters. And the style of this film is going to be different because there's three different directors, one directing each part of the film. So hopefully it'll all turn out well and be actually stylized in a different way than you've seen zombie films before.
With fun, games, gathering, and lots of makeup magic, the VSU students prepare themselves for a shot of the spotlight. The movie Waking Up to Hell will be presented at this year's Valdosta Film Festival on April 25th.
Be sure to mark your calendars because Waking Up to Hell, the working title, will appear at the Valdosta Film Festival April 25th. This is Cameron Nesbitt. For VSU News 11, I'm Cameron Nesbitt.
Thanks for joining us today. I'm Neil Folger.
And I'm Joy McCullough. We'll see you next week.